We are thrilled to have in studio someone who is very near and dear to you if you've watched television any time over the past 50 years or so.
It was time to plant the crops, but after 17 years of pulling the plow, poor old Bessie was worn out.
Well, why didn't you just get another mule?
Well, Bessie wasn't a mule. She was a big fat lady who pulled farm hogs. Well, come on, Blanche. If she was too old to pull a plow, how could she ever pull a tractor?
Hello, muckrakers.
Mary, I just dropped by, dear, to tell you to be sure to stop in my studio this week. I'm devoting all my shows to you poor, unfortunate single girls.
Sue Ann, in case you've forgotten, you are single also.
Oh, yes, but that's only because I don't happen to place my love life above my profession.
I thought that was your profession.
Oh, Murray, Murray. Jokes fall from your lips almost as fast as hair falls from your head.
Hey, wait a minute. Ball jokes. Wait a minute. Hold on now. You know Betty White, of course, as the happy homemaker Sue Ann Nibbins, and you know her as Rose Nyland from the great Golden Girl show, and so many of the most popular shows that have been on television. Game shows, dramas, you name it. She is truly one of the most talented and one of the most successful performers ever on television. And she's being honored today, but also just spending some time today with the Museum of Broadcast Communications here in Chicago for brunch with Betty White that'll take place at the Palmer House at noon today. And we'll talk about that coming up in a few minutes. She's a five-time Emmy Award winner. Six times that I've... Did I six, but who's counting? I missed one somewhere along the way. She has won numerous awards and is very involved, of course, in animal welfare issues. What a pleasure to welcome to our studio Betty White. Good morning.
Good morning, Dean. Thank you so much.
And I forgot to mention in all of the credits, born in Oak Park, Illinois.
Right across the street from Chicago. The hospital on one side of the street is Oak Park and the other side is Chicago. So that's as close to Chicago as you can get.
Now, I know that you went to school in the Los Angeles area and I think graduated from Beverly Hills High. So were you just a baby when you were here? And
I was born here, yeah. And went out to Los Angeles when I was a year and a half old. That I don't think California was a state yet. I think it was still a territory. But
so unfortunately, your memories of growing up here don't really exist.
I've been back and forth.
Yeah.
So
did you work in Chicago ever? Do plays, films, anything?
I did. I did a play here years ago. I did Any Wednesday here. I can't think of the name of the theater. Forgive me for that. But I've always loved Chicago. When I was growing up as a little kid, my mother and dad were both born and raised in Chicago, mm-hmm. reared in Chicago, and I was always, you know, Chicago, early on was, oh, Chicago is so busy and it's so this and that, and suddenly it went through this whole metamorphosis. It's one of the most beautiful cities, not only in the country, but in the world. I love Chicago.
Well, I hope we...
I'm not just trying to... Please, anybody.
You're right.
Mean it.
Yeah, I hope we gave you a good impression as you were coming in from the airport yesterday. You came in right in the middle of St. Patrick's Day madness around here that can get a little ugly.
Once we got out of the airport, it got very Irish very quickly. I mean, people of any ethnic background became Irish.
Right, exactly. Betty, when you listen to these clips from, you know, from the Mary Tyler Moore show or from the Golden Girls, I mean, you know, we were chatting before we went on the air and having a little coffee, but your face lit up when you heard, you know, some of the setups and some of the jokes. I mean, clearly these were high points in your life.
Oh, of course there were high points, but I am the luckiest old broad on two feet that I got blessed with the kind of writing. I mean, the writers on both Mary Tyler Moore and on the Golden Girls, and then latterly David E. Kelly, you can't get any better than that.
Right.
How blessed can you be? And it's all on the page. You know, the actors take so much credit for roles they play. We couldn't do it if it wasn't on the page.
Yeah.
We we can help a good show, but we can't save a bad one.
Yeah, well, that's true, but it still is very collaborative. I mean, the writing has to be there, but I can't imagine any other actress bringing to such dimension to the roles that you've brought.
I wouldn't give them a chance.
Not if they didn't want to break their necks that day. Was Sue Ann Nivens as conceived as it turned out to be? I mean, you must have put a little flourish on it and changed it up a little bit.
I don't know where she turned into the neighborhood nymphomaniac, but somehow it worked, and she thought she was so spectacular and so gorgeous and so sought after. It was only in her own mind. Nobody else felt that way.
Yeah. Did you guys have a sense of the kind of television history that you were making while you were doing the Mary Tyler Moore Show? Or, you know, was it, you know, we're going to work today, we've got a, you know, pretty good script, we've got nice people, but, I mean, this will be one of the great television shows in the history of the medium.
It was on for 7 years. I didn't come in until the fourth year. But Mary and her then-husband, Grant Tinker, and my husband, Alan Ludden, and I were best friends. So we sweated out the show with them. We would go to rehearsals. We would go to things, and never dreaming that I'd be on the show at some given point. But that first year was tough. I mean, it was very iffy. It didn't catch on right away. Mm-hmm. In fact, they weren't sure it was going to get picked up for the second season. But by the time it got over the 4, 5, 6, 7 years, I think even the network knew they had something.
Yeah. Is there a little Betty White in Sue Ann Nivens? Because, I mean, I've interviewed you several times for different movies and things, and you're always so sweet and you're always so nice. But part of me wonders, is there a little bit of that, you know, evil?
They used to ask Alan that. Sue Ann Nivens, of course, was the perfect happy homemaker.
Right.
She could do anything. She could fix anything. She could cook anything. She could, if you had a spot on your clothes. And she was this magnificent cook. And Alan said, well, Betty and Sue Ann are very similar, except Betty can't cook. And so that's about the size of it.
So that was about the size
of
it.
Yeah, and I think everybody got suspicious, Phyllis particularly, when her husband took Sue Ann home from a party, drove her home, and he didn't get in until the next morning.
Yeah.
They somehow had to swerve to avoid hitting a dog, and she got suspicious when he came home with his clothes cleaner than when he left home. it was such writing.
This is a little Sue Ann Nivens, and this is so quintessentially Sue Ann. You'll be able to hear it on the speakers.
Why do you want to be on our show? You're the happy homemaker.
Yes, and the happy homemaker is very unhappy.
About what?
I have done that show every day since July 1963. Do you know what that means, Mary? It means I've been smiling for 11 years.
I never thought of it that way.
I want to tell
And that's what it comes down to. That's what the happy homemaker on camera, always, always smiling, Sue Ann Nivens, always conniving a little bit to see.
And the minute the camera went off, she was a real witch.
Yeah. Well, and you know, we had some other clips. We pulled some other clips also of Sue Ann's affection for Lou Grant.
They're so
visual. So much of what it is visual, and you know, wouldn't make sense on the radio. But it was a great relationship.
She finally nailed him. She finally did get him. But he came in the next morning. One of my favorite shows. He came in the next morning, called Mary into his office, went over to his desk and opened the bottom drawer and took out a bottle of whiskey. And he said, "Here, nobody should get that drunk."